What's up, all you cool cats and kittens? Welcome to
The Breakdown.
On what episode?
17. I'm pretty sure.
Right? 17.
17.
Nah, then eventually we'll get to 71.
Ooh. Still quite a while till then, but.
But we have a lot of new music. It's so much coming out. It's being awesomely ridiculous to listen to. Too much to listen to.
It's going to be a good year.
We're going to talk about Mammoth's new album. That's Becca's all-time favorite of all time, including Evie right behind you. She's like, yep.
Yeah,
hey guys, what's up?
Oh, she's just chilling. Yeah, we love Mammoth in this house.
Then Atreyu's new album, and then I consider it going to be one of the big best upcoming metal albums of the year. Wristmeetrazor. Very
the most emo name ever.
Yeah, and it's gonna directly sound like what you think sounds like. But first, we're gonna talk about Mammoth's new album, Mammoth by Wolf Van Halen.
Yes, Mammoth WVH debut album just came out on Friday.
Of the son, if you didn't already know, of Eddie Van Halen.
Yes. Son of Eddie Van Halen. He wrote all the songs, plays all the instruments, and yeah, he was a one-man show for this album.
For making
which
it.
Which I think is pretty cool.
Now they're going on tour.
Yeah, for making it.
Yeah.
But he's going to go on tour and he'll have a whole band. And he has a great lineup for that too, so.
Like, I saw a picture of Wolf Van Halen.
I did write a full album review about it on Bandit, if you want to check it out.
They reposted it as well.
Yes, Wolf and the Mammoth artist page posted it, so killed it there, I guess. But
look how happy he is. Look how happy that joyous happy face of in studio of writing his first album.
Yeah, and he did it all in the Van Halen studio 5150, so that's pretty cool too. And two of the songs he used the original Frankenstein guitar, which is also cool.
That is pretty cool. So we're gonna talk about, I love this album. I finally got to listen to it this week. And I liked it more than I thought I would like it. No offense, not at all.
Yeah, no, I was curious to hear what you were gonna think about it, because I wasn't sure if you would like it or not.
It gave me STP vibes. Stone Temple Pilots plush album, like that good, like hard but radio friendly rock, just like riffs after riffs after riffs and catchy lyrics.
Yep, no, I agree there for sure.
The whole album has like literally every song has a great one riff that carries on through the whole song, but it's really catchy.
Yeah. It is stacked with some catchy riffs for sure.
It's like I personally didn't care too much about the slower songs that were, I didn't think they were my forte. Not that I don't like slow songs, I do. I just didn't like some of them, but like the way he chose to lay out the song tracks, it started off hard and then it went slow and then it finished off kind of like in that in between level.
Yeah, it was a nice progression. I liked the slower songs. Well, I really like Distance, but that I think like Distance wasn't even originally supposed to be on the album, but because his dad passed away, he added it. And I think it ended up working pretty well, but I personally like every song on there.
And I this album art is so freaking dope.
Yeah, the album art is really cool.
Like, probably already 1,000 people have this tattooed somewhere. This crab with a car somewhere on their body. I guarantee it's been a tattoo now, an idea. And it would be over. It would be a sick tattoo, I won't lie. I can see it on my calf.
Already envisioning spots.
Did he ever say in any interviews or anything about the artwork and why he chose it?
I think he did, but I could not tell you what he said about it. I think pretty much he was just like, it's cool. Like, why wouldn't you have a huge crab holding a car? But don't quote me on that. There might have been a deeper meaning.
Or he was watching an episode of South Park and he was like, crab people on an album cover. They are real crab people.
Yeah, that too. That could definitely be the reason.
So let's go into your top favorite songs of the album and why. Why are they your favorites?
Oh, gosh. I don't know. So I've been listening to it nonstop and it's really hard to pick favorites, but I'm not even gonna. So I think probably You're to Blame, which was released as a single, is a favorite for me.
I was to blame. I was like, whoa, that's not my fault. I didn't do anything.
I'm blaming you for this. No, the song You're to Blame, which was released as a single. And then, let's see. I really like Stone. And then maybe Epiphany or Resolve or Circles. Oh, God, I don't know.
I like them all. Why are you putting me on the spot?
Yeah. There's just like certain pieces of each song that I'm like, ah, damn, this is good. So it makes it hard to choose.
I really love the riff on Don't Back Down.
Mm-hmm.
It's fucking killer. And again, it's a simple riff, but it's like, it's so nice. Like that.
See, I could add this to one of my favorites too.
Like, I feel like I could only be in Kill Bill right now. I like it. Vanity. Really simple, catchy riff. And like most of the songs, they always have that one main riff and it carries on through the whole song.
Mm-hmm.
And I dig it for that because it works really well. He wrote the riff so easy to add other guitar tracks on top of it, but that riff is still awesome in general.
Yeah, I think that works throughout the whole album. And like he keeps a very signature sound, I think. And it's all like very layered. Like you have that catchy riff, but then he layers on more guitar and the drums are really good too, I think, on this album. But yeah, I like that one a lot. That one I like to turn up in the car and jam out.
So I will say there's not as many solos as I thought there would be on this album.
Yeah, I don't really know if I expected a lot of solos. I think he did say something in an interview, like, I mean, he's not going to play like his dad. So you're not going to get a bunch of stuff like that, but.
Wails, squeals, and freaking 15-minute crescendos.
Yeah, technically, the whole thing is a solo, because it's just him doing it solo, you know?
Bam!
Is he? No. Yeah, but
there's Mr. Ed, little solo nerd. The opening song was freaking awesome too.
Mm-hmm. That one started and I was like, oh damn, we're off to a good start.
Like, I dig it. Again, simple riffs, but it's catchy and fun. This song is what put me in like the STP vibe, the Sons of Pilot vibe. Like, and hearing the voice, like, it sounds like a great, catchy 2000s or like late 90s, 2000s alternative rock album.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with that timeline.
And the lyrics for Horribly Right were on point. Oh yeah, this riff sick too. I really like this riff. There's a lot of great riffs.
There are. I know when I was writing my review, I felt like I kept like talking about riffs. I'm like, geez, I need to talk about something else. But I mean, there's good riffs in every song, so.
Whoever helped him with writing too, they did very well with making him like really great hooks. Great hooks, very catchy. Singable.
Mm-hmm.
Horribly Right, I think, was my favorite well-written lyrically song. What happened? Uh-oh.
My cat just jumped. Evie jumped up. She's trying to get in. Oh, you might see her in a minute. Evie. Guest appearance. What do you think about the Mammoth WVH album? What are your thoughts?
Two blinks. Two blinks if she's holding you captive.
Blink if you like it.
Dang.
She's been listening to it all day.
But I'm curious who helped them with their lyric writing. Like, you know, what songwriters did he work with to come up with the ideas?
Yeah, I'm not sure who he worked with writing wise. If I had the album, I'll go look. I'm sure it's online though. Yeah, it is a really nice like album to sing along to. Very catchy, a lot of radio friendly songs.
It's definitely like, I consider like a summer album, like totally top down, cruising back, going to the beach, having some of those new Bud Light, whatever seltzers everyone's drinking.
Oh gosh, I did catch my parents listening to it at the pool, so I guess it does have those kind of vibes.
I think it's going to be... I honestly think it's going to be up for a Grammy. One of the songs. I think one of the songs will be up for a Grammy.
Yeah, I could see that. He's performed pretty well on chart so far, so I haven't looked to see how the album's done since Friday, but I have a feeling it will do pretty well.
10 out of 10 recommend. Buy now.
Yeah. Yes. Buy it. Buy it, and then you can stream it later.
Exactly. I want to do the Atreyu new album. I was so weird about this album because, like, I don't know. I don't know how I felt with Alex leaving the band and Brandon coming up for vocals.
Mm-hmm.
And like one song they released, it was exactly what I expected. And I was like, I'm 50-50 on this album. I like this album if it wasn't an Atreyu album. Like if it was a different band name, mm-hmm. I would like it more. Like if he wrote this as a Hell or High Water album, which is a side project band that he does, which is way more lyric based and musically based and softer. more catchy, mm-hmm. radio-friendly rock, I'd be fine with that. I would say it's a fucking banger. But since it has the Atreyu name, I don't like it as much as it should be a different name.
You don't think it's like heavy enough for the Atreyu name?
Yeah. That's just like, I don't know, because it's like one of those moments when you share someone like new, they hit a new demographic of listeners, mm-hmm. and they go back to their discography. They go to the number one song, probably like Bleeding Black Mascara or something, or Right Side of the Bed. They play it like, what the hell?
yeah, that's true.
They about comparing. To get their mind turned.
yeah, I get what you're saying. I didn't know what to expect either, but I like it for the most part, and I am a big fan of Brandon's vocals, so.
He has great vocals. Brandon is a great singer and drummer.
Yeah.
He really mm-hmm. is. But like songs like this one, Warrior, that threw me off. Like when I said that Atreyu name thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like this one was just like the lyrics were incredibly simple.
We have a lot of
and I think Warrior is actually probably my least favorite one. There's no substance. And it kind of goes back to like this meme I saw like this with Travis Barker.
Yeah.
Where it's just like Travis Barker working with right rappers. You do pop punk now.
This is a song is definitely like their mainstream song. Like pulling Travis Barker.
Yeah, and the song's like, I mean.
And it's not like heavy at all.
No, it's super anthem song.
Yeah, very anthem.
Like, I could see this being played in WWE, maybe in like baseball stadium, the anthem songs.
Mm-hmm.
Like, these lyrics feel like a skillet song.
Yeah, it does.
Like they're just, I don't know, they're very simple, and it totally reminded me of Skillet.
So yeah, like, Skillet does do stuff like that, like, I forget what their songs are, but they have the one song like Legendary, which I feel is very comparable to this one.
Yes, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I didn't even think about that, but I definitely get that.
And then also when I'm hearing this album, it sounds very much like the new Beartooth, like on the production side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see that too.
Which I love new Beartooth. Love new Beartooth. But it just like it sounds similar in the style format of like the Beartooth new album.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is pretty similar.
My favorite song, hands down, was Underrated. That I think that's their heaviest song, actually.
It might be.
I really dig it. Like, it felt like a guilty pleasure saying, like, I dig this song.
There's nothing wrong with liking this song.
I think this is... I hope they do this one on their tour, which is also I'm curious about what their tour coming up with, like Crown the Empire and Tetrarch. Mm-hmm. Are they going to be doing the old song with you singing Alex's voice?
I didn't even think about that. That'll be interesting.
But I love this riff.
I really like this one.
Get the fuck up. Like, this is good. This is a sick song. Like, if they made that whole album like this, I would be totally okay with it.
Mm-hmm.
Because their bass player came in for like the screaming parts right here. Watch it.
Oh.
Yeah. That's not Brandon, it's their bass player. Which I'm fine with that. That's cool. And I think this is their heaviest song on the album. And then I'm okay with this clean part lyrics. It's really catchy. This works really well. 100%. Mm-hmm.
Well, I always liked that Atreyu was a mix of like heavy vocals and clean vocals. Yeah.
I think that's the best song on the album that shows like how, you know, Atreyu was like their, you know, their traditional mold of heavy mm-hmm. and
clean. Yeah.
And that's yeah. my favorite riff from the whole album right there, that opening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that one is a good one. It's probably one of my favorites off of it, for sure. But majority of the album is not as heavy.
Which again, like I said, I'm not opposed to it if it wasn't Atreyu's name. Like right, even when I bring it up, I'll even bring it up on Spotify. Their top songs right now. And I know why it's their top songs, because it's getting more radio play. Like I pretty much sure all the single releases that Atreyu released for this new album got rotation on SiriusXM.
SiriusXM, yeah.
Like before that, I never heard Atreyu ever get played on SiriusXM. Maybe on Turbo, like Bleeding Mascara and stuff, mm-hmm. but nothing else ever before that. So like,
here yeah, actually, I think I've seen like tweets about them from SiriusXM like all weekend long.
Yeah, so, like they're like, popping up. Their three of their singles, these songs were, I think they released a single. Warriors got 400 million streams. Save Us 600 million. I mean 6 million. And I'm wondering if it's that new demographic they tapped into that's listening to it.
Mm-hmm. Very well could be.
And then look at that. Wow, even like
coming in the like right old, side of the bed is slow.
Yeah, even their old stuff is even down lower now.
Bleeding Mascara didn't even make the cut.
I did also really like I did like Baptize. So that.
Yeah, I did too, actually. Thank goodness, because that's the title track.
I dig this. And I like the riff on it, too.
Yeah, I like the riff.
This song is what gave me the most similarities between a Beartooth song.
Mm-hmm.
And I do like the mixing on this. Whoever they worked with for producing this, they did it really well. They made a great transition.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this riff's really cool. And that's the bass player doing that.
Right, yeah, I didn't know he took over the heavy vocals.
So Brandon's, like, clean vocals are awesome.
Yeah. I love his voice, so... That is not missed, but because thankfully we still have that. But
what about you?
It's a bit different.
Some of your favorites from the album, your takeaways from it.
I gotta pull up the freaking album. I did like Baptize. I did like Untouchable. What other ones like? Underrated, we talked about. Did I like Dead Weight? I can't remember. Yeah, I think I did like the heavier ones, and not that I thought any of them were bad. I just think it's funny that you brought up the Skillet comparison, because that's kind of the vibe I got from the Warrior one. Just very, like, I don't know, simple anthem.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Simple anthem lyrics that It's catchy, it's cool, but it just, and again, like when I hear Skillet, that's all I think about is they just make anthem rock stuff, you know, WWE, walkout music, stadium music.
Yeah, it wasn't bad, but it wasn't, it just wasn't something that I want to like crank up and listen to on repeat like I did with other.
I do think this is a very creative artwork for their album.
I love the cover. Yes. I love the contrast of the orange and blue too.
That was a smart decision. Much better than the previous album they released. I think it's Time Is Now. That is my least favorite album. I didn't like that artwork.
Yeah, I did not. I'm not a big fan of that artwork either. This one's like super eye-catching, very cool. Like I would buy merch. Like that, I'm looking at that blue vinyl right now. I'm like, I need to get this?
That's a cool vinyl. That's legit.
Yeah, that looks fire. That looks so good. I'm gonna go buy it. Oh, wait, stop! Damn it.
Marketing wise, they did a great job on this. And they're gonna be on tour for support of it. Which again, I'm very totally curious about what songs they're gonna play without Alex there.
Yeah, that actually has me a little bit more excited to go just to see how they do that. And obviously to see Tetrarch.
I'm working on my review on that. I have all my notes from that one to send over when that goes live for everybody. Nice.
This week.
I got, again, a mixed feelings on it. I like it, but I like it if it wasn't an Atreyu level. That's my forte on it. And I would tell fans, like people, like if they're like old Atreyu fans, don't listen to it as an Atreyu album. Listen to it as like a brand new band in your head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like if you're expecting the early stuff, you're not gonna be.
And it's cool, or respect, you're not gonna get that. I understand. I remember one of those metal rock elitists when bands falter and do or change your style a little bit. I'll go with it to an extent and whatnot. And like this one, I still do like it, but again, like I said, maybe if they just did that, made it a different name, I think it would do better. I think actually even marketing wise, it would probably even done better too. Like former members of Atreyu, new projects, blah, blah, blah. I think that would be a bigger like hype.
Could have been. I'm all for artists like changing and doing what they want to do, and like I said, I don't not like the album. It's just like it's not my favorite, but
I do like
it. I'm sure better than what?
Than the previous one, The Time Is Now. Much better than that one.
I do like, oddly enough, really love The Time Is Now, the single. I don't know why, but I do. But I'm sure with this album, if I listen to it more, I'm sure I'll like some more songs better than I do now. But first couple listens in, I'm not like dying over it.
But everyone can have their own personal opinion about this album. Obviously, a lot of people like it. If there are three songs from the album already in their top five on Spotify.
Mm-hmm. True.
Which I'm really curious. I wish they would release like demographics statistics on like the songs, who's listening to them on Spotify, like the age groups and stuff like that. That would be really interesting.
Yeah, that would be really interesting.
Watch like all the 30-year-olds are listening to like X's and O's in the first album.
And then the younger demo is listening to the new stuff. That would be really funny to see. I'm just in a corner listening to Bleeding Mascara, crying, over and over again, and not everyone else.
I just hear remaster. Yeah.
Oh gosh. Good times.
Great time in my life. I'll go back to that time. But next one.
Now to get a little bit more emo.
Fuck yeah. This is coming back to 2000s core. All right. And I loved this freaking, I even tagged it and sent it to them. They loved it. So the band is Wristmeetrazor.
Wristmeetrazor.
Which they have stuff older before, but this is like their first release in, I think, almost a decade. I think so. I'm gonna check this real quick. Dang. I think so. That's what I really like Spotify for talent, like actually putting the year it was released on there.
Yes, I appreciate that so much. I look.
Oh no, take it back. Sorry. Their last song before that was in 2019. And then they had another album, I think that was, their debut album was in 2019, which is actually, it sounds similar. They're like, it's a different change, but a great change from that, their first album. I think this is like up for one of the, like, I would say like a breakout band for this year.
Very nice. Sorry, I'm looking at their, the names of things are really great.
Oh no.
Goodbye, Sweet Betty.
Your face is frozen.
Oh no.
Oh no, it's not anymore. Okay, cool.
Okay.
I gotta even say, even the album artwork for it, it just brings back 2000 vibes. And
yeah, it does.
It's such 2000s core. And it's like when I put in a text to Becca, so 2000s cores, I want to bring back black eyeliner under my eyes again.
I almost sent you, mailed you some eyeliner, some pencil eyeliner, so you could fill that.
Fuck yeah. bringing up their...
Also, the fact that it's like all one word, Wristmeetrazor,
yeah,
is so, so emo. I love it.
I'm gonna share. I really hope they go on tours to do this because I want to see them live. But this is their album artwork. I dig it, and I really dig their vinyl.
Ooh.
They even have the girl on the inside of the vinyl.
That is very nice.
That's fucking dope.
That is
beautiful.
They have
different vinyls too, which I like this black
one. Oh, I love that. My gosh.
And this is the band itself. Like, that's 2000s right there. That's great. I love it.
Yes.
Oh
my gosh.
I first found them through their debut single. It was actually shown on... I got an email from Alternative Press, and they're like, oh, brand new single from Wristmeetrazor. I'm like, who are these guys? And I checked it out. I'm like, holy shit, biscuits, what is this? Republicans across the country are moving. I love everything about this. They have, the whole album has so many riffs in one song. But it works. It's like people always say you can't make an album off riffs. They proved them wrong. Like every song is like a bunch of riffs put together, and it works so well.
Ooh.
And I'm pretty sure like they're playing a drop C, which was like, that's the iconic way of like Bullet for My Valentine back in the day. So it even makes it even more 2000 rock. I fucking love it. I put this song as one. I'm going to make a playlist of like top contenders for metal songs of the year, and this is one of them.
Mm-hmm. The red eyeshadow. Yes.
Oh, I love this riff right here. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So freaking sick.
Oh yeah.
Did you get a chance to listen to the album?
Not the whole thing, no.
And I really appreciate the way they layered the album. Like most albums, I don't care about transition pieces,
mm-hmm.
like transition songs, but theirs are kind of sick and it works really well with going into the next song.
Yeah. See, I don't know. The other day when I was listening through these different albums, sometimes, you know, Spotify automatically does the shuffle. And I was like, this album does not, like, it feels so random because it just wasn't segueing very well. And I was like, oh, wait, it's not shuffle. So, like, I don't know. I feel like it's, for me, I mean, who really listens to an album all the way through, I guess, anymore. But I've been trying to do that. And when you listen to an album from beginning to end, I feel like it's really important for it to flow.
Yeah. Like when I was going through this, like I heavily listened to this, like, and it's a short album. It's only 33 minutes. Like, and they have like maybe three like intermission type stuff, like not intermission, but transition pieces.
Mm-hmm.
One that I really liked, and it gave me like Nine Inch Nails kind of vibes to it, was mm-hmm. the 99, 44, or 100.
Mm-hmm.
Bring it up right now. But it was just like, it's like literally this whole album is like everything you loved about 2000 rock.
Yep, this whole thing.
I'm seeing this as a soundtrack to a vampire movie already.
Yeah.
Queen of the Damned. Vampire Lestat. Blade. This is totally on the Blade soundtrack.
Very Blade. Very Blade.
It's sick. I loved it. Like, I didn't think I could thoroughly enjoy an album, like, making me go back in time to a great... Mm-hmm. genre of that time period. I think I hope they do a music video for this one. This will be like my next big favorite one is Psychopaths. I think I'm saying it right. And it's another song.
Yeah, I really liked the intro to this one.
Yeah. The riffs are just so freaking cool, and the mixing, whoever produced this album, fucking A+, dude. Like, I think, where's it at? There we go. I just covered this part. I heard it and played this riff.
Oh yeah, this takes me back.
They just did it. It's like, how do you put a whole like time period of rock in one album? They fucking did it.
Mm-hmm.
So great. Props to them. I really hope they get like I think they're. This was like last year for me. Code Orange was the breakout album of my year. This is my breakout album.
This one. This year.
Yeah, 100%.
That, and we still got like half a year left. So that's saying something.
Hey, Code Orange last year came out in February, and I was bumping that thing like all year.
True. That's a good point. When it's good, it's good.
What other thoughts you think about it? How do you think the 2000, I think 2000s rock is getting a revival.
Yeah. Agreed. And I feel like even if you're not like, even if it's not on your radar, like if someone watches this and gets to this point where we're talking about them, I think people will be like, oh shit. And like kind of revert back to those days. I mean, it's nostalgic, but it's new. And it sounds really good too.
Yeah. It's not like, I love it for the fact it's not like what everyone else is doing right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Completely 100%. Not what everyone else is. I don't think this band's going to get played on Sirius XM, which is totally fine by that. 100%. Mm-hmm. I'm okay with that. That's not the vibe that Sirius XM is picking off. And I'm cool with mm-hmm. that. Because there's a bunch of other bands, like last week when we did Show and Tell, that the Air I Breathe, that band, I thought that was another great 2000s vibe sound.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm thinking that's getting a revival, and I'm okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think it's necessary to, like, be on Sirius XM or whatever, especially when it doesn't, like, really fit. Like,
yeah.
And this is the kind of genre that, like, it wouldn't have made sense even when this was popular. Like, this genre was, like, very popular for it to be, you know, mainstream on air, I guess. But people who like this music are going to find it in different ways.
And it was, like, I was even listening to Old Bullet, like, you know, Poison and stuff like that. And there was, like, I'm going back to this time period. I'm, like, damn, I didn't appreciate it enough when I was a kid. Like how mm-hmm. awesome their riffs and lyric writing were back then, and for how young they were, and just appreciating it more so now, especially with a band doing a similar style like that and keeping it alive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely did not appreciate it on that level back then.
We were just wearing black eyeliner and looking cool and all black and buying stuff from Hot Topic.
Yes, pretty much. That was the situation.
This is another case where I also think, though, their name may be a hindrance, just because it's like, you know, wrist meets razor.
Mm-hmm.
Very aggressive and assertive, and it mm-hmm. may not attract, you know, may not get enough attraction because of the name.
Yeah. That's a good point.
Because it's like, I think they'll get brushed under too much because of their name. But I hope that's not the case, because I want this band. I really think they can be blown. This is a great band. This is a sleeper hit band.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, hopefully it doesn't hinder them in any way. I like it for what they're doing, but.
But yes. Three new albums.
Three new albums.
Three. You decide.
All.
What's that?
All different vibes.
Totally.
Mm-hmm.
Totally one, I would say, alternative rock. I would say chart rock for the Atreyu album, and 2000s core rock.
Yep.
100%. Oh, yeah.
We're all across the board today.
It's great. So hope everyone else, curious what everybody else thought about these albums and all the good jazz. No show and tell, because we just showed you three albums.
It was a whole show and tell. A whole show of show and tell.
Exactly. But yeah, check out the albums. See what you like, your favorites. If they become
your favorites,
your top rock. Maybe you agree with us on our perspective. Maybe you don't. But that's what's about everyone about music. We all like music in a different way.
Yep, 100%. That's the beauty of it.
Well, Till next time.
Catch you later. See you next week.